bless the saints. You're never alone. Just wanted to remind you of that. Good evening. Good Wednesday evening to all of you. I want you to allow Miss Tori Kelly to bless you a little bit. It is so good to be with you all. You're never alone. Just want you to understand that. God bless my girl, Miss Princess, all the way from the East Coast. We love you, girl. Let's talk soon, would you please? I would love to chat with you. So glad to see you. So glad to see you. We miss you dearly here in Mount Calvary. And with all of these ambitious things that we're doing, yea, the Lord God saith, or the Bishop Witherspoon one saith, one or both of us get thee back to Seattle. We love you, girl. Good to have you with us. Got a good lesson for you tonight. But let this bless you just a little bit, and then we shall move into our session for this evening. You're never alone. Hallelujah. Praise God for the fact that we are never alone. Yes, Lord. Let's just pray. Father, we're thankful for your grace and goodness and mercy. Thankful for your kindness. Pray that you would be with us, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Thank you for all who will watch this evening and tune in. May we all be blessed because of it. May your word go forth. May we remember that we're not alone. May you be in the midst of us on this night. Speak life to your people. Speak victory, success, and prosperity. I bless you and I bless your people in the mighty and matchless name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Miss Washington, good to see you, my dear. I'm so glad you're back to Seattle. You know, we're back having physical worship. You need to sign up so we can see you physically. But praise the Lord for you and for all of you. I hope you all are doing well. Everybody having a good week. The Lord has been favorable to all of us. And you're never alone. We're going to have to let Tori go. But I want to remind you that whatever's going on in your life, you are never alone. God is always with you, and he moves by his spirit. So let's get into the word of the Lord. Such an interesting time in which we are living. And I think that the church has come to the place where we have to really, really reckon with whose side we are on. That may seem a bit simplistic to some of you. Like, I know whose side I'm on, but do we really, really, really know whose side we're on? I mean, it seems that the Christianity that we know is being watered down in many instances and convoluted in many ways. And this generation of young people, young adults, and Gen Z, bless you, Missionary Curry, and our young people, they're just, many of them are looking. They claim that they're not religious. They're tired of what we would call organized religion. They call themselves spiritual. And we've got to really understand what happened, that the church kind of got off the course and lost our way a bit. This does not indict all of the church when I say this, but to a great extent, if law has lost our way, and a lot of people are turned off by quote unquote organized religion. To me, Christianity is not a religion. I am not religious. Christianity is the intelligent living out of a lifestyle that has been ordained by God. So it's an intelligent living of a lifestyle, not a religion, as it were. We label it religion because, you know, religion is just anything you can be devoted or dedicated to. There are a lot of religious alcoholics, religious drug addicts. So I don't consider myself religious. I consider myself a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. We use the word religion again, but Christianity is more than that. So we've got to get us back on course. This young adult generation is interested in viable ministry, relevant ministry, not just clapping our hands and teaching a bunch of do's and don'ts. But what are we doing? Bless you, Sister Patricia. We love you so much. We praise God for you. What are we doing that's changing people's lives? Are we crying out against injustice? One of the things I learned about our young adults, our millennials, and young adults they demand transparency. It's time out for us trying to act, particularly in the pulpit, preachers trying to behave in such a way that suggests we're perfect. That's what gets many preachers in trouble to begin with. We hold them to a standard that they're not able to live up to because we're human beings and imperfect, make mistakes. It's not a license to do anything wrong, but in our humanity, things don't always go the way we would like. I'm not talking about willful sinning and voluntarily premeditated sin, but we're human. And we can't be held to a standard. I always like to be transparent and say that I'm not preaching, I'm not teaching tonight because I'm perfect. I'm teaching because I'm forgiven. Yes, God is a forgiving God, and He looks beyond our faults to see our needs. And so our young adults need to know that those of us preaching and proclaiming the word are not perfect and have made mistakes. But they also need mentorship. Young adults need to listen. You need to know that, as in every generation, none of us have all of the answers. And so you need to be open to receiving from your elders. I mean, one of the things that has really served me well is my ability to have older people in my life at all times speaking into my life. I think that is so very important. So we've got work to do, saints. I believe the other side to this coin is that there is a revival forthcoming. I believe it so much. I really believe that we should get ready because a tremendous move of God is on the horizon, on the order of the first and second awakening that we knew about in history, on the order of the great Azusa revival in 1906, 1907. I believe we're going to experience something. America needs a reckoning with God. We need to come back to God. And the church, much of the church has lost its way. Some of you watching even tonight, even with this pandemic, it has served two purposes. One, those of us who, the first thing is it should have drawn each of us closer to God. If you come out of this pandemic the same way you went in, you've missed it by a million light years. God is speaking, and He's asking that we would come to a higher place in Him. As the songwriter wrote, Zion is calling me to a higher place of praise. I've received that, and I've really spent my time really pushing myself into greater relationship with God. I can't be the same person. This pandemic has awakened me to even a higher height and a deeper depth in the Lord spiritually. But also, it's going to show how serious you are about your faith. Some of you have become very relaxed being at home watching via Facebook live stream, YouTube, etc. When it's time to come back to church, please, please, I beg of thee, don't be complacent in that regard and just say, I'll just watch it online, the service. That will be a vehicle that will be available to you. But it is so clear in Scripture, from Genesis to Revelations, that God created us to be in community. He speaks in the New Testament, says, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together in the house of God, as the manner of some is. God called us to be together. He ordained the local church. In the New Testament, they were in small houses. Apostle Paul traveled around Asia Minor and started churches and put people over those churches. Many of them were just little small houses, but everybody needed to be in community, in a church community. And so that is very important. So please keep that in mind. We've been talking about how to be free from bondage. And I want to thank Elder Williams, Elder Jason Williams, for filling in last week as my wife and I went and got rejuvenated a bit. Down there and went to Palm Springs just to kind of relax and, just get away. Been in the city for over a year and just toiling away and pressing forward. And I just needed to just kind of rejuvenate, request your prayers, because God is doing some marvelous things, I believe, through Mount Calvary, and some of which we're ambitiously moving into. We need a miraculous move of God. We need a divine intervention. I believe God's going to do it. So when we left off, we were talking about being free from bondage. I want to talk about the danger of yielding to temptation. I think this is going to bless you if you stick with me. If I were you, I would hit the share button, and I would encourage some people to watch this. I'm so glad again to just see some of you on. So praise God for Mother Betty Harris Jackson. We love you. She's known me since I was a kid, and I praise God for you. God bless Miss Oglesby, always on. My good friend, Pastor Irma Melton, all the way from Dallas, Texas. So good to see you. We love you with the love of the Lord. I know you're in the region, and we're hoping to see you before you get out of here. My wife and I, looking forward to it. Good to see Donice and just all the saints. Miss Paula, God bless you and Brother Ford. And just, I can't always call everybody out, but I just praise God for you. Good evening all the way from New Orleans. And so we're so glad to have you with us. And so let's delve into the words. Hit the share button. This is going to bless you. The danger of yielding to temptation. I'm going to challenge you. God has put in my spirit to whatever I do, God said, here's what I don't want to be guilty of. Going to heaven, being judged by God, and God saying, you were afraid to say what I put in your mouth to say, because people didn't want to hear it. That won't be my testimony, whether you want to hear it or not. I'm going to say what thus saith the Lord, and it's between you and God from there. But you know, what we have to understand as saints is that demonic influence is real. The devil is real. Now, one thing about the devil, we've got to set some things in order. Oppression is here. Well, first of all, the devil is not, as I've mentioned before, he's not omnipresent. That is to suggest he cannot be everywhere at the same time as God is. So the devil has to use tricks and scheme. That's why he's described in the Bible as a liar and a deceiver. He's likened to a snake. You know, you can't trust a snake. The devil is cunning and crafty. Now he has to use his demons to do his bidding, because he's not omnipresent, nor is he omnipotent. He doesn't have all power, but demons are real. I believe, I don't have Bible to back this up, but I believe the devil has unleashed the very last batch of demons he had available to his access for the 21st century, as he knows that his time is short. Friends, devil, demons are real. Now, I do know that Christians cannot be demonically possessed. It is an oxymoron to have the spirit of God and the spirit of the devil in you at the same time. But you can be influenced by demons, but you cannot be possessed by demons. But the world, those who are non-believers, many of them are possessed by demons. Some of the things that our country, is even illicit drugs are trying to make them legal. Listen, illicit drugs, even this marijuana and some of, I'm telling you, saints, do the research yourself. The stuff they're putting in this marijuana, this stuff, much of it is demonic, and it's changing people's minds. It's altering chemicals in the brain. Alcoholism is a demonic force. So many things are demonic that we don't even consider. That's why our country and our world is in such a terrible place, because folk are engaging in demonic behavior and don't even know it. Some of these things we're doing, demons are real. And they know that they can't defeat the church, but they sure want to try and influence the church. And so I want you to know that bondage comes from yielding to temptation. If you want to walk, now you can be saved and walk in bondage, even though the Bible said, whom the Son sets free is free indeed. And so if you're free and not bound, what the problem is, some of you walk right back into the very bondage that Jesus, through his blood and his resurrected power, has set you free from. And it just doesn't make sense to say, I'm saved and I know Jesus. I believe that he went on the cross and died and rose on the third day. I believe his blood has set me free. And then to walk back in the very thing that you've set free from. It can happen if you're not doing the right thing. But we are free. So bondage comes from yielding to temptation. The more you yield to temptation, and if you are human, you will be tempted. If you're Christian, you will be tempted. And the more you yield, the more you render yourself open for bondage. You yield to temptation when you're enticed to do things your own way. I need you all to get that. You yield to temptation when you are enticed to do things your own way. Come on, somebody. God bless my good friend, First Lady Griffin, all the way. She's got Seattle roots all the way from Memphis, Tennessee. We love you and your husband with the love of the Lord. Please say hello to him for me. So we've got to, it's just good to have all of you here. Stay with me. I think this is going to really bless you. You might want to take some notes. Again, I would hit that share button. Somebody needs to see this, because I'm not going to be guilty of not trying to lead the church to where God wants us to go. I am going to say what God says. Say, we've watered down the Christianity. We really have, and we're doing things that are not biblical. A lot of things we're doing aren't going to land you in hell, but they render you weak. They render you unanointed, and they take the testimony of the church away from us. So we've got some challenges. So temptation is not a sin, but it can lead to sin. We all are going to be tempted, but it can lead to sin if it is not dealt with. And here's the thing, the devil knows what it is. Somehow he's able, probably because over the years we've testified, we've kind of, you know, like in, I don't know much about, amen, Brother Roberto, love you, man. Always good to see my man, my cousin, my deacon, my everything, my traveling companion. We love you, man. But, it's, you know, it's kind of like, I don't even know if this man, because I've never played poker, but I think in poker, the idea is to not show your hand, obviously. I have played spades, and I didn't want people to see my hand because you try to bluff people and all that. And I just want you to know that the enemy, you know, we show our hand to him too much. Pray for me because the devil did A, B, and C. You open your mouth and you keep saying things, and the devil hears it. He assigns a demon and attaches to it. Come on, somebody, and then there you have all kinds of Pandora's box that opens up. Let me just say it is so good to have our good friend Bishop Derek Hutchins, one of the prince of preachers in the Church of God in Christ in America. We love you, man, and we praise God for you. Keep doing that great work. That's my friend. I'm so glad. I tune in on him every now and then. He tunes in on me, and we're just praising God as we try to press the gospel and the kingdom of God forward. So again, I say temptation is not a sin, but it can lead to sin if not dealt with. And now here's the thing: when you are born again, watch me, you become spiritually alive. Are you with me? But your flesh, everybody, I can't hear you, but say my flesh. What is your flesh? Your flesh is your sinful nature. When you become born again, you become spiritually alive, but your flesh or your sinful nature always wants to challenge your commitment to walk in the Spirit. Remember, please, you have these two natures that duel at all time. There is, on the one hand, the nature of God, the nature of Jesus Christ in you, and on the other hand is the nature of sin. When you are saved, the nature of Jesus supersedes and overwhelms the nature of sin. And that's why Paul said, but we got to keep it, and it kills that nature, but it's not dead to where it can't rise again. Paul said, sin revived and I die. He said, I die daily. You've got to learn how to kill sin every day. We're saved, but we have a sinful nature. We have the nature of God and we have the nature of sin. Are you all with me? And one of those natures every day will have precedence in your life. And it's all about the choice that you make. Because we're saved, we don't have glorified bodies, so we still have to deal with the nature of sin, even though it has been covered by the blood of Christ. We must learn how to keep it covered. So we have to always understand the enemy wants to challenge your commitment to walk in the Spirit. Now, the word tempt, in the Greek, it means tempting or testing one's strength to resist sin. So the Greeks see that as, and what we're trying to say here is the enemy wants to test your strength to resist sin. Oh, no, that's not a laughing matter, but that's what he wants. So he wants to test your strength to resist sin. You will be tempted. And this knucklehead somehow finds out what it is that you like. Now, he's not going to tempt you with something that he knows he does not have a chance with, even though he's not omniscient. He doesn't know everything. Somehow, the enemy gets this information, and he's going to bring to you that thing that can render you weak. Are you all with me? Temptation is an invitation to live independently of God. And some of us walk in, you know, we yield to temptation. And sometimes we think of temptation in these big, grandiose sins, but not necessarily. It could be the littlest thing, the temptation to open our mouth and say something against someone we should not say, the temptation to hold a grudge, the temptation to not forgive. It could be any number of things. The devil tempts you with what he knows you will like, as I said. One of the great evangelists, Billy Sunday, said this, quote, temptation is the stuff of which Christians are made. If the devil never tempts you, he cannot develop your resistance to sin, or you cannot develop your resistance to sin, end quote. So if temptation is the stuff of which Christians are made, if the devil cannot tempt you, or if he never tempts you, you cannot develop your resistance to sin. So you're going to be tempted, but it helps develop your resistance to sin. Let's look at something. Let's talk about some channels of temptation. Stay with me. This is going to bless you. Some of the channels of temptation. Would you go to the book of 1 John? That's over there toward Revelation for those of you who don't read quite regularly. 1 John. Let's look at some channels of temptation. 1 John. This is powerful. Now, I'm going to challenge you all I'm worried, Saints. I'll be honest with you. I'm worried about the church in some regard. And again, when I say that, I'm not indicting the entire church, because God said he would never leave himself without a witness. But I'm worried that some of the things we are doing, there is a Bible scripture, there is principle in scripture that teaches against it. The problem is, I believe, I don't have this data, but I believe with all of my heart that the average Christian, I mean the average Christian, is not reading the Bible with regularity. I believe that because the Bible said, you know, a tree by the fruit it bears. It's very obvious by some of the things we do, some of the clothes we wear, some of the things we say, some of the places we go, some of the things we think are okay. They're not, some of them are not sins, but they're weights. And the Bible said, lay aside weights and the sins that beset us. You cannot, you know, I was watching, big fellow for the Seahawks, the wide receiver, DK Metcalf, running and, you know, in a 100 meter sprint against some of the top sprinters in the country, and this man really hung with them in a great way. He's just a big, massive, fast guy. But what I noticed about every single one, it was 9 lanes, and every one of them, they had their warm-ups and all those things on, but when it came time to run, they took as much off as they could legally take off. Now, the problem with some of us, because you cannot run 100 meter effectively, you can run it, but you probably won't win if you keep your sweats on. Are you with me? And so some of you are running this Christian race, but you're not running effectively because you have weights on. They're not sins, but they're weighing you down. I need you to be challenged by that. Look at 1 John chapter 2. This is the word of God. Everybody say, this is the word of God. Do you still believe the Bible is the word of God? Now watch this. 1 John chapter 2. Let me begin with verse 15. I don't know. Some of us just really don't read this verse, obviously. John says, now the whole book of 1 John, is the premise of it is that if you're saved, you don't practice sin as a lifestyle. His whole point is, if you are saved, you are not a habitual sinner. He gives us instructions. One of the first books I encourage new converts to read is the book of 1 John, the book of Romans, and the Gospels. Now, John says, and do not love the world or the things in the world. 1 John 2:15. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Saints, you can't make it mean what it's not saying there. This is what he's saying. Do not love the world. What is the world? Now, that's the big key. You know, as a kid, you know, they made everything the world. You couldn't go play basketball. You couldn't go roller skating. You couldn't go bowling. You couldn't do anything because it was all worldly. Well, no, everything is not the world is not the physical cosmos. That's not what he's referring to. He's referring to a system, that system that leaves God out. Don't love that system which leaves God out. Now, we can make some simple deductions of systems that leave God out. Now, you know, we have to understand that God, hear me now, is the God of the universe. But Satan is the small god of this worldly system. All right, this system that is unspiritual, this system that leaves God out, this system that does not consider God. Love not that. He says, do not love the world or that system which leaves God out, or the things that are in the world. Anyone love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. If you love that system that God is not a part of, then the love of God is not in you. For all, here it is, here, watch me now. All that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but of the world, that system which leaves God out. The world, that system of sin, that system of evil, is about the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. The Holy Spirit does not entice you in the lust of the flesh. The Holy Spirit does not entice you in the lust of the eye. The Holy Spirit does not entice you in the pride of life. No three of those does the Holy Spirit ever entice you to do. Come on, somebody. And the world is passing away, verse 17, and the lust of it. But he who does the will of God abides forever. So look at it. Love not the world. Saints, y'all gonna have to make some decisions. Some of the things we're doing, some of the places we're going, again, they're not sins, but they're weights and they're worldly. Come on, somebody. Some of the people we interchange with, you know, even in and gospel music. And I don't, you know, I'm not the guy trying to be, I'm not an old-fashioned preacher, but I'm a Bible preacher. And there are principles in scripture that preach against some things, and that's why things are so watered down. There's some things we're doing are lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. Some of the things we're engaging in are worldly in their nature. Proof is in the pudding. We don't see, come on somebody, we don't see the anointing of God, the supernatural power, the divine authority of God. We don't see his authority and power really moving. Man, when I was a youngster, man, you know, everybody would talk to the saints, you know, many of them were very uneducated. Very, you know, when I was a kid, not a whole lot of African-American saints were really going to college, getting advanced degrees and all those things. But boy, did they have faith that puts many of us with advanced degrees to shame. They had faith. They had faith. They had incredible faith, and they believed God, and they had power. They had authority. They had anointing. They fasted. They prayed. They believed God for miracles. They believed what the Bible said. Now we're so intellectual. We're so intelligent. We got to try and deduce everything into our cognitive brains, which cannot handle anything that God does. Our minds are not, we're not God. We don't have the capacity to try and comprehend God in our intellect. And so we get ourselves in stuff because this New Testament church of the 21st century, we're too engaged in everything but fasting and praying and studying the word and saying, God, what is your will, man? I'm concerned about my grandkids and your grandkids. You know, if you're like me, you got about another 40 years and then you got to pass on to eternity. And 40 years is not a long time. Most of my life has already been lived. That's my reality. For many of you, that's your reality. What are we leaving? Are we leaving a true gospel of Jesus Christ with this generation? Or are we leaving a water down? If we keep watering it down, then that's all they know. Then they pass it on and they water it down. Next thing you know, Christianity is null and void. That's why many of our people are engaged in things like the Black Israelites and all these confrontational religions that have elements of truth but are not the truth. And we've got to, because Paul said, always be ready to give a reason for your faith. And many of you couldn't even talk to a Muslim, you couldn't talk to a Jehovah's Witness, you couldn't talk to a Mormon, you couldn't really defend your faith. Shame on you. That's why so many of our young people don't want this, because we don't even know how to tell people why, what Jesus is all about, why my life has changed, and why I'm glad, what salvation is all about. Come on, somebody. So, you know, you can't rationalize God. That's way above your pay grade. Are you all with me? That's what I love about the scripture. If I don't know anything else, it's about faith. Faith, 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 faith. Everything in scripture is about accepting what you can't see, believing what's not there, releasing your cognitive, releasing your ability, your whatever it is, your idiosyncrasy, releasing your thoughts and saying, God, if you said it, I'm just going to put it by faith and believe it. So here it is. All that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. Let's look at it first, the lust of the flesh. See, the lust of the flesh preys on your physical appetite. You all with me here? The lust of the flesh. Everybody say it. I can't see you. Say the lust of the flesh. It preys on your physical appetite. It draws you away from the will of God, the lust of the flesh. You stay with me. I'm trying to help you to not walk in temptation. Listen, being Christian is more than just hoping to go to heaven. It's living the life down here. I'm convinced that many people are not getting real conversions. I'm not here to judge people, but again, the Bible said you know a tree by the fruit that it bears. Apple trees do not bear pears. Pear trees do not bear oranges. They bear pears. Orange trees bear oranges. Are you all with me here? And if you're a Christian, you should be bearing the fruits of a Christian, because 1 Peter 1:4 said the divine nature of God lives in you, lives in me. The nature of God, and I say it often, but you all know, all of us knew our daddies at some point, and you know we all got some of the nature of our father in us. Some of it good, some of it bad, some of it not so good, but we have it. I am Rayon Witherspoon Sr.'s son. I know, because there are several things of his nature that I got, and that's just what he passed on to me. And so it's not hard for me to identify with my father because he passed those things through my DNA from his DNA. Now, if the nature of God is in you, his spiritual DNA is in you, you ought to look like your father. You ought to act like your father. You ought to talk like your father. God is holy. God is righteous. God is unspotted from the world. God doesn't like sin. And we can't be perfect. That's not what I'm preaching. But if the nature of God is in you, you ought to hunger for God. It ought to hurt you when you sin. It ought to hurt you when you're not moving in power. It ought to hurt you when you're not moving in the anointing. If the nature of God is in you, how are you struggling to forgive? What if he would have struggled to forgive us? If the nature of God is in you, how are you so, why do you backbite and run your mouth? That's not the nature of God. There again, we have these two natures, sin and the nature of God. We've got to let the nature of God do his job. It is not automatic. It has to be your volition. So those things draw us away from God. Listen, and destroys your dependence upon God. Let me say it again. The lust of the flesh preys on your physical appetite. Your physical appetite. It draws you away from the will of God, and it destroys your dependence upon God. Satan tempted Eve in the garden through the lust of the flesh. Let's look at it. Genesis chapter 3. Let's go there right really quick. Genesis chapter 3. Watch this. I'm going to read verses 1 through 6. He tempted Eve through the lust of the flesh. It started way back in the book of Genesis. Chapter 3, verse 1. Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. Cunning, that's who and what he is. And he said to the woman, here he is having a conversation with Eve. Has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And then the woman said to the serpent, we may eat the fruit of the trees of the garden, but the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said. God made it very clear, you shall not eat it, nor shall you touch it, lest you die. That's how we started dying. When Adam and Eve sinned, we were not supposed to die. We were supposed to live forever. But when sin came in the world, it generated death. The serpent said to the woman, you will not surely die. And the devil always lying to you. Man, why do we listen? Why do we listen to that? I said something the other Sunday. If you can believe, if you can doubt, you can believe. You can have faith. If you can doubt, you can have faith. If you can listen to the devil, you can listen to the Lord. Come on, somebody. If you can fall into temptation, you cannot fall into temptation. If you can mess up, you cannot mess up. Come on, somebody. If you can hate, you can love. You got to understand, it's all your will. For God, he says, knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes, watch it, the lust of the flesh, your eyes will be open, and you will be like God, knowing good from evil. And here it is, lust of flesh, verse number 6. And the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant for the eye, and desirable to make one wise, Don't miss that. This is what the devil tried to get her to see. And so she took of the fruit and ate it and gave to her husband who was with her. That there it is. You know, you see the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eye there. You see both in action, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eye. Listen, the enemy is always trying to show you, trying to appease your appetite, rather. You have a choice, brother. That's exactly what I'm saying. The enemy is always trying to appease your flesh. Remember your sinful nature, that gratification you get in your symphony. And here's the thing. There are things in all of us. Come on now. I'm being transparent. All of us that in our sinful nature, in our flesh, we like. It gives your flesh gratification. It does not serve your spirit. It grieves your spirit, but your flesh likes it. That's the challenge. Do I do what my flesh likes, or do I do what my spirit likes? And so even in Matthew chapter 4, remember when Jesus had fasted for 40 days and he is now, you know, he's in the wilderness and the enemy comes to him. And I'm going to actually read in Matthew chapter 4 and verse 3. I want you to see it. He says here, now when the tempter came to him, the tempter came to Jesus, so you know he's coming to you, and said, if you're the Son of God, command these stones to be made bread. That's dealing with the lust of the flesh. Command these stones to be made bread. But Jesus said, devil, you crazy. He said, man should not live by bread alone, but every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. You notice in that discourse in Matthew chapter 4, every time the enemy tempted Jesus, Jesus referred him to the word of God. Hallelujah. And that's how you not yield to temptation. You know the word of God. The temptation of the lust of the flesh is designed to draw you away from God's will. The temptation of the lust of the flesh is designed to draw you away from God's will, and it's always going to be something that your humanity likes. You're going to have to deal with that. That's all there is to it. God's not going to take that away from you. You've got to deal with that. So, and it does it so that you'll serve your flesh or your sinful nature. The reason it wants to draw you away from God's will so that you'll serve your flesh or your sinful nature, thus not rendering yourself strong and might. I believe in the power of the anointing. I believe that we can lay hands on the sick and they be healed. I believe that we can cover our kids and grandkids and keep demonic spirits and evil and all those. I believe we can keep them away from our children. I believe that we have power and authority, but we got to get it in our spirit. We got to stop walking in the flesh and walk in the spirit. Let's look at another passage that I think will bless you. I'm going to turn over to Galatians chapter 5. Galatians chapter 5. I want this to bless you. I believe that Galatians chapter 5, this is good. Look at verse 16, Galatians 5, 16. Remember, we're talking about the lust of the flesh. Galatians 5, and I want to read 16 and 17. He says, so I say then, watch this, walk in the spirit and you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Do we read the Bible anymore? God is teaching us how to be strong Christians. He said, verse 17, for the flesh lust against the spirit, spirit against the flesh. That's what I was talking about earlier. And these are contrary to one another so that you do not do the things you wish. They're always in a fight. Look what he said. I say walk in the spirit. That word walk in the Greek, it means to live or to conduct one's life. And so he's saying conduct your life, or it means to live in the spirit or to live according to the will of the Holy Spirit. Conduct your life according to the will of the Holy Spirit. Now, so when you talk about folk, that's not conducting your life according to the will of the Holy Spirit. When you hold grudges, that's not conducting your life according to the will of the Holy Spirit. When you are unforgiving, that's not conducting your life according to the will of the Holy Spirit. When you're backbiting, that's not conducting your life according to the will of the Holy Spirit. When you don't like somebody, that's not conducting your life according to the will of the Holy Spirit. He said, you do this. You walk in the spirit. Conduct, it has to be your volition. You can say, Holy Ghost, help me all you want. He's like, I already helped you when I filled you with the Holy Ghost. I gave you the power to do it. So you got to know that the lust of the flesh desires to fulfill your physical needs. Are you with me? In the ways outside of God's will. It desires to fill your physical needs in the way outside of God's will. Thus, it leads to bondage. If you allow it, you can be saved and bound even though God set you free from it. Bondage like eating too much. But the lust of the flesh, I'm going to say it again, it desires to fulfill your physical needs in ways outside of God's will. So thus it leads to bondages like eating, like sex addiction. And what happens when people, talking about abstinence is like, in the 21st century, that's not by God's standard, but for many it's taboo, but it's the will of the Lord. Because when you keep engaging in those kinds of activities, sexual activity with somebody you have no future with, you tie your soul with that person. Your soul is your thoughts, your will, and your emotions. And when your soul, your thoughts, your will, and emotion get tied up with somebody you have no future with, it's a wasted effort. Now you got all that, and say you might meet somebody who may be the person, but now you got to untie your soul from a person that you had no future with. And so it's best to just not get engaged in those kind of things. It leads to all this stuff, eating and sex and drugs. That's what happens when the lust of the flesh that desires to feed your physical need, it will lead you outside of the will of God, and it will lead you into these kinds of bondages, drugs and alcohol and those things. So the verse that I read, remember, 1 John, love not the world nor the things that are in the world. All that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. Let's look at the second one, the lust of the eye. We talked about the lust of the flesh. Let's go back to Genesis chapter 3. For the lust of the eyes, the same passage as we just read, but verse 4 and 5 show the lust of the eye. Then the serpent said to the wife, you will not surely die, for God knows that the day you eat, your eyes will be open and you will be like God, knowing good from evil. Now that's enticing. Who wouldn't want to be like God, knowing good from evil? And so he got her with the lust of the eye. He showed her why it would be to her advantage to eat of that forbidden fruit. And you know, it's kind of like King David in 2 Samuel chapter 11. I've been to Jerusalem and I saw where David's palace was, and they show the vicinity where Bathsheba was bathing outside, and where David's palace was, he could clearly see that. It was very, very obvious, clear to do. So he got his soldiers out to war. He's got his soldiers out having war. They're out fighting, and David goes outside his balcony and he sees what he's not supposed to see. So when he sees it, he has an option to turn the other way. He sees Bathsheba and she's bathing, with nothing on. So he's got an option. Okay, I can just go back into my palace and act as though I didn't see that, or I can let it affect me in a wrong and negative way. So he decided that he would just kind of continue looking, and got him in trouble. So he brings Bathsheba over, he lays with her, and she gets pregnant. You know, he brings her husband Uriah in, he puts him on the front line to get him killed so that he can have this woman to herself, all because of the lust of the eye. He saw that woman, said, I gotta have her, and it got him in trouble. The child didn't live. I mean, David got in so much trouble because of the lust of his eye. It wasn't even worth it. And so that's why you got to watch things like particularly for men. The enemy knows that men are visual. Come on, somebody. And so if he can get you into things like pornography, you know, you don't hear a lot about women engaging in pornography, but men, it's something there, because it's the lust of men. Men are visual. They have to see. They like to see things, and it'll get you in trouble. So, pornography is an abnormal. It's an abnormality. It's not normal to desire pornographic material. It's not the will of God. But if you see something that you shouldn't see, you've got to immediately get yourself in a place where you don't allow it to be effective in your life. You've got to watch the lust of the eye. You see things you want, and then you want them. That's the whole deal here. Things that are not good for you. Jesus was on the mountain. Remember the same thing in the wilderness. And so now the devil takes him on the top of the mountain and says, you see all that out there? I'll give you all of it if you just bow down and serve me. And Jesus is like, devil, how are you going to tell me you're going to give me what I already have? Did you not read in Psalm 24, the earth is mine and the fullness thereof? The devil is a joke, folks. But he wants you to see things that you should not see, so you can do things that you should not do. Now, everybody will be exposed to something that you're not supposed to. You're going to have to decide what you're going to do when you see that thing that you're not supposed to see. The lust of the eye. That's why he's always bringing things, even women, we're all visual. So much of what's going on in our world is visual. That's why, through the pandemic, the cinema became big. You've got what? You got Netflix. You got Amazon Prime. You got all this stuff. You probably got 600 shows if you got cable that you can watch. Because he knows if I can get people to see stuff they shouldn't see, even if they don't watch me now, if they don't, when we're almost done, even if they don't participate, it'll contaminate their spirit. Yes. If you keep looking at things that you shouldn't look at, it will contaminate your spirit. So watch that. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye. And then finally, so Jesus, he rebuked the devil on the mountain, and like, man, if ultimately he said, get thee behind me. That's what you got to do. And so the final one for tonight is, again, how this is going to help you to deal with the dangers of deal with temptation, and how to not the dangers of yielding to temptation, how to not yield to temptation. Is the final one he talks about is in the First John passage, is the pride of life. Now, a lot of folk aren't guilty of the lust of the flesh, lust of the eye, but the pride of life, man, oh man, I've never seen so many proud people in my life. Oh my God, trying to pastor today with people who are proud, can't be corrected. Man, they used to rebuke us openly. They used to rebuke us in church, man. We knew who the pastor was preaching on from time to time. I mean, they didn't let us get we but we weren't proud people. We weren't inundated with our world now is so prideful. This new age world we live in, this postmodern world that we live in, this time that you know, where temptation in this new age time, in the postmodern time, the temptation is to control your own destiny. That's what it's all about, controlling your own destiny. Thus, you don't believe that there's a God controlling your destiny. It's you ruling your own world. That's what this new age, that's what this postmodern world is all about. It's you being your own small God. So many people don't even believe in God anymore. It's you being your own small God. There again, let's look back at Genesis chapter 3. We see the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. Let's look at Genesis chapter 3 and see how this thing shakes down in verses 5 and 6. Now watch this, the pride of life. Look at 3, verse 5 and 6. For God knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be open and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. So the woman saw the tree, that it was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eye and desirable to make one wise, the pride of life. So she took of its fruit and ate it, and she also gave to her husband who was with her, and he ate. The pride of life got them in trouble. Are you all with me? Pride says take charge of your own life. You don't need God. You can handle it yourself. That's what pride said. The devil has to first, if you're going to have any access in your life, as we wrap this up, he has to first, watch me, bind the strong man. I mean, spiritual warfare is so serious in the scripture. It is so real. He has to bind the strong man. You know, in everybody, we all have a strong man that wants to be in charge. It's either the spirit of God or your sinful nature spirit. So when you're saved, watch me, when you're saved, your spirit is indwelt by the spirit of God. When you're saved, let me show it to you in Romans chapter 8, verse number 16, he says, the Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. So when you're saved, I want to say it again, your spirit is indwelt by the Spirit of God. And so whatever, watch me, whatever becomes the master of your spirit becomes an attribute of your character. Don't miss that. Somebody ought to type that in. Whatever becomes the master of your spirit becomes an attribute of your character. You can put that on your Facebook, on your Instagram, hashtag Bishop R.C. Witherspoon. Whatever becomes the master of your spirit becomes an attribute of your character. Remember, when you're saved, your spirit is indwelt by God. And so the enemy wants to try and master your spirit because that's what's going to become an attribute of your character. Let me give an example. If your spirit is mastered by fear, then you'll always have torment. You'll always have anxiety. You'll always have phobias. You'll always have a lack of faith if your spirit is mastered by fear. Let me give you an example. If your spirit, even though you're saved, if your spirit is mastered by lust, we've got to command our spirit. We got to take care of our spirit like we take care of our bodies, like you brush your teeth every day and you take a shower or bath every day. You like you eat food to nourish your body. You got to take care of your spiritual life. Come on, somebody. Whatever becomes a master of your spirit becomes an attribute of your character. You've got to understand that. If it's, again, the spirit of fear, then you live in those ways. If it's the spirit of jealousy, then you have a revengeful spirit. You have a spirit of rage. You have a spirit of anger. You have a spirit of hate over you. You have a spirit of strife and envy and contention. That's the spirit of jealousy. But here's the thing. You must attack these spirits at the root. Whatever's trying to take hold of you, go to the root and cast it out. Because, you know, if that's why the Bible said don't have the root of bitterness. Don't let the root of bitterness set in. Because why? Because when something is rooted, then it's way down in the ground. Are you all with me here? And it only manifests after the tree has grown in my backyard. It's an interesting concept. The last couple of years, I've been in where we are like 25, 26 years. And so right, there's a fence dividing me and the neighbors behind me. And so all of a sudden, those roots from those big trees in my neighbor's yard are growing up into my yard. And you know how I feel about my grass. These big old roots that I didn't even know were there, but I see the manifestation of them. And now it's very difficult to deal with it because it's a strong, It's a vibrant 25-foot root. I'm telling you, you better leave. You better watch the roots of bitterness. You can't let roots, you gotta attack these things at the root. That's why you still have some family issues in your life. You're not attacking them at the root. Stay with me in just a couple more minutes. You gotta attack them at the root. Look at Matthew chapter 18. And I want to read verse 18. Says, "Assuredly I say to you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Jesus is saying, whatever you bind on earth, in other words, whatever I have bound on earth, you can agree and unbind and bind in heaven. Whatever I've loosed on earth, you can agree and loose in heaven. That's why the enemy doesn't want you to read the Bible. He doesn't want you to know what God has has bound and what he has loosed. He has loosed healing, but you got to know it. He has loosed prosperity and favor, but you have to know it. He has loosed healing and forgiveness, but you have to know it. He has loosed peace of mind, but you have to know it. Loose the things that God has loosed them in your life and bind up fear, bind up frustration, bind up doubt, bind up bondage, bind the things that God has bound, loose the things that he has loosed. So you've got to understand whatever you bind on earth is bound in heaven. And so if you allow the Spirit, these things, the master of spirit, behave accordingly. In other words, so if they say if there's a spirit of perversion, then what's going to master your spirit is sexual perversion, abortion and child abuse, incest, as I said earlier, pornography, a filthy mind, chronic worry. Listen, Satan must first bind the strong man. Oh my God, can I listen? So the strong man is your spirit man. But if he can render your spirit man null and void and let you think you're saved, but you don't have any, he's my grandma, you ain't got no power. I've bound that strong man in your life. He knows he can win the battle. And so here's what you've got to do. You've got to let God master your spirit. Lord, I can't do this on my own. I yield to, every time you do what God says do, you're letting him master your spirit. Every time you yield to the will of the Lord, you're letting him master your spirit. Every time you say yes to the Holy Spirit, you're letting him master your spirit. So if you have the spirit of heaviness, then there's rebellion that'll be on you. It'll manifest in self-righteousness. It'll manifest in self-deception. It'll manifest in strife and rejection of God. Listen, again, you need to loose a humble and contrite spirit. You have the authority to do it. Bind and loose in your life. If you have the spirit of infirmity, then there's depression that you'll have to confront. There's oppression that you'll have to confront. You'll be weighed down. You'll have a heart trouble and things like that. You need to loose the spirit of life and healing. Loose it. Jesus has already loosed it. Bind that stuff and then loose the spirit of God, spirit of love and life. Now, finally, I want to ask the question, and we will be done. How do you escape the spirit of temptation, which leads to bondage? So you've heard me teaching all this. How do we escape it? Let me give you four ways really quickly. Number one, you must allow God to break your will. You must allow God to break your will. So your will is your soulish or your outward man. Remember, your thoughts, your will, and your emotions. You must allow God to break your soulish man, your will, your thoughts, your will, and your emotion. Lord, break it. Lord, break whatever you got to do. It may not be comfortable, but Lord, break my will. Break my thought, my will, my emotion. Let my thoughts be your thoughts. Let my will be your will. Let my emotions be your emotion. Because without the breaking of your will, listen to me, your spirit man cannot come forth. Without the breaking of your will, your spirit man cannot come forth. Thus, you will remain bound. Is there anybody, you again, I hope you'll share that. Some of you may be like, I'm not bound. Temptation doesn't get the best of me. Praise God. This is not just for those of you who are watching who don't have it. It's for you to give to those who are struggling and need to hear this kind of teaching. And so let me say it again. You've got to understand something. Without the breaking of your will, your spirit man cannot come forth. So you will remain bound. Allow God to break your will. But number two, if you're going to escape the spirit of temptation, which leads to bondage, again, one, you got to let God break your will. Number two, bring every thought under the obedience of Christ. Amen. As soon as it comes, bring it under the obedience of Christ. Every thought, I don't know. So if I'm a bishop in the Lord's church and crazy thoughts come to my mind, I know they come to yours. Come on, somebody. But what are you going to do with the thought when it comes? Let me read to you 2 Corinthians 10 and 5. He said, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. He's talking about spiritual warfare, and you got to bring every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Bring your thoughts under the control of Jesus Christ. Number four, confess and then resist. Confess and then resist. Confess, Lord, this is where I'm having some challenges. Look at 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. If we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. The word confess means to agree with God, to say with God. If you say to God what you know he already agrees with about your situation, your sin, if you agree with God that I'm wrong, if you agree with God that I need you, he's faithful and just to forgive you. Confess your sins. And then James 4 and 7 says, resist the devil and he will flee from you. And that literally means, you know, when he says resist the devil and he will flee from you, if you look at that in its Greek rendering, it literally means if you resist the devil, he will run in terror from you. Are you all with me here? If you resist the devil, he will run in terror from you. And that's why we got to, I just want to read that so you can see it. James chapter 4 and verse number 7. I think it is so very, very important. Therefore, submit to God, resist the devil, and he'll flee from you. Submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. These are the ways to escape the temptation of lead to bondage. One, allow God to break your will. Two, bring every thought on the obedience of Christ. Three, confess and then resist. And finally, four, depend on the power of the resurrected Christ. But depend on the power of what Jesus did on the cross of Calvary and when he was resurrected. Depend on the power of the cross and the resurrection. The final verse I'll read is Philippians 3 and 10, that I may know him in the power of his resurrection, the fellowship of his suffering, being conformed to his death. I am telling you, depend on the power of the resurrection, that I may know him in the power of his resurrection. How is that? What was the resurrection? It was victory. What was the resurrection? It was healing. What was the resurrection? It was glory. What was the resurrection? It was taking complete control over the devil. The resurrection rendered the devil null and void. The resurrection defeated everything the devil thought he was about. The resurrection gave the victory. The resurrection gave the healing. The resurrection gave the deliverance. The resurrection gave everything that you need. The resurrected power of Jesus gives you the authority to walk free from bondage, free from temptation, free from frustration, free from doubt and fear. Kyle, you gotta know that it's all there. He did it for you and he did it for me. So the Lord bless you real good. I hope that this message, I hope that this teaching has been a blessing to you as it has been to me. I hope that it's challenged you, but I hope that it's also helping you to say, look, again, thank God, man, for some of you like Bishop, thank God, I've learned how to deal with temptation and you just reiterated it. You know, you maybe gave me a few nuggets that can be even more helpful. And bless you, Christian. I'm so glad that you were blessed by this. We miss you, girl. We love you with the love of the Lord. Bless you, Nichella. We praise God for you. And but again, maybe you need to give this to someone. Just tell them, look, it's close to an hour's teaching, but you need to get this because it will bless you. Saints, it's time for us to move in power. The Bible said the kingdom of God suffers violence and the violent take it by force. It is time for us to just take over the devil's kingdom and bind him out of our children, cast him out of our will and our life, cast him out of our family lineages, and cast him out of our family strongholds, cast him out of our grandchildren and great-grandchildren. It's time to get this generation back in love with Jesus. Will you all help me do it? Let's seek the Lord. Fast and pray. Fast on Tuesdays and Fridays. Pray. Get into the Word, and let's move in the Word of the Lord. God bless you, McAfee. We love you so much with the love of the Lord. Thank you for being blessed by the teaching. We praise God for all of you. Don't forget, this Sunday, we've made a declaration that we're going to come physically. Those who are going to be there, and those who, bless you, Brother Roberto, we love you, man. Can't wait to get together and have some kind of fellowship. You just let me know when you're ready. I'm double vaccinated, so I'm good to go. All these conspiracy theories running around from all these neophytes, all these novices who have no understanding. I'm listening to the professionals, not you novices who don't have faith. Ultimately, my faith is in God, and that's all there is to it. Amen? And so I believe by faith that God has blessed me with those vaccinations. Thank you, Dr. Hutch, Bishop Hutch, doing a great work. One of the great men in the Church of God in Christ. We love you, man. We praise God. Looking forward to some fellowship, having you come up here and preach in our convocation, and me coming to share with you and just having great fellowship. We want people to be exposed to your wonderful gift and ministry. So again, I say this Sunday, we've declared that we're going to have an incredible worship experience. I was teaching last week on the power of praise. The Bible said God inhabits the praises of his people. And we're going to come physically and we are going to leave everything at the door but praise and worship. We're going to go in 100%. We're going to give God worship. We're going to give him praise. And if you, there's still time for you to sign up to come in, come, you know, we're observing all the social protocols. And it's going to be amazing. We're going to just praise God because he is enthroned in our praise. It's going to be a special praise time, a special worship time. And if you can't make it, you want to tune in, you want to invite somebody to tune in. I want you to literally be standing and be ready to sing and worship God. Something is going to happen in the atmosphere as we praise the supreme, magnanimous, hallelujah, exquisite and amazing, gratuitous God who has been better to us than we deserve. So I'm looking to see you this Sunday at 10 a.m. It's going to be an incredible time in the Lord. Get the word out. This is a special service I'm calling us to where we're going to praise and worship God in a special way. And I am declaring that something mighty and miraculous and phenomenal is going to be released in the atmosphere. Hallelujah. Into the atmosphere and healing is going to take place. Somebody's financial breakthrough is going to happen. I'm telling you, your career is about to blow up. I'm telling you, amazing things are going to happen. Some of you, your loved ones are going to begin wanting to know Jesus. It's going to be great things. You don't want to miss this Sunday if you've ever decided to be at church. If you were planning on tuning in somewhere else, don't know. You need to come to Mount Calvary, even if it's going to be through Facebook Live or live stream or YouTube is going to bless you dearly. And I praise God for it. If you want to be a blessing to the work of the Lord, every thought's got to be, sister, washing under the obedience of Christ. Every thought. This stuff is powerful what I talk, but it requires a lot of work on your part. I'm telling you, it'll change your life. It's keeping me sane. Yes, it's this works, I am telling you, but it's a lot of work. Sometimes we're too lazy to get the blessings of God. We want God to drop everything in our lap. No, you got to go get it. You have to go get it. Stop being lazy. Stop feeling sorry for yourself. Stop all that stuff. Nobody said life was easy. It's a challenge. It's work. But put in the work and get the great results. To God be the glory. Please be a blessing to the work of the Lord if you feel so inclined. You can go to our website, Mount Calvary CC, and give. You can you can text your giving, Mount Calvary CC, to 77977. You know, you can give on the phone app. You can give through the through our Cash App, MCCC Give. There's so many ways you can give. Be a blessing to the work of the Lord. May this be a great remainder of the week for you. Would you pray for me, please? Your bishop and pastor needs your prayers as I pray for you. God is dealing with me. Pray for me. Also pray that we get a miracle. We're looking around for where Mount Calvary's new location is going to be. You all are going to see it coming up. We've already had an architect draw up some renderings. We are serious, y'all. Yeah, but we need God to give us the space, give us the location. I need your feverish prayers that God will give us wisdom, God will give us grace and favor, that he'll divinely intervene and perform a miracle on Mount Calvary, in Mount Calvary, because the best is yet to come. Unto him who is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, now and forever. And everybody shout amen. God bless you. God bless you. I can't wait to see you Sunday. It's going to be an incredible service. Enjoy the rest of your week.